हेलो बाय 21, थैंक्स फॉर ज्वाइनिंग। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई होप यू ऑल हैव बीन डूइंग वेल विद योर करंट सेमेस्टर। सो आई वेलकम यू ऑल ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स क्लब टू दिस इंट्रोडक्टरी सेशन टुडे। ओके, सो आई विल नॉट बी फोकसिंग ऑन द क्वेश्चंस, दे विल बी आंसर्ड सब्सिक्वेंटली, डोंट वरी अबाउट दैट। सो टुडे वी वुड मेनली बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट सम बेसिक्स व्हिच यू नीड टू अंडरस्टैंड द ब्यूटीफुल वर्ल्ड ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स। And then we will talk about some major projects done by Electronics Club in the past and what we all have planned for you guys in the future. A side note, just try to stay with us and try to understand whatever we are teaching you or trying to explain you. If you guys feel we need to slow down at some point, do tell. And if you have any doubts, do use the chat box. Also, while answering any questions that we ask during the session, you can unmute yourself and answer. Okay. So someone asked just now, what we all do here. So Electronics Club is not only about electronics. We put our hands upon whatever we can. We think of some ideas and bring them to reality. Well, that's how technology has been developing so far. Okay, so first of all, I need to state this, that we obviously don't have any requisites for this club. And the only thing require at first sight is your enthusiasm or your desire to work hard. Okay, so start by a short question. So first of all, you need to tell what this picture is all about. Can you guys guess what this picture is showing?
It's ENIAC.
What? Can you use the chat box? ENIAC. Okay. Supercomputer. Okay. Anything else? First computer. Some sort of old computer. Morse code transmission. Oh, interesting. Okay. So one of you, two of you get it. It is a primitive computer, like someone said, the first computer. So yeah, it was built around 1822 and mainly developed by Charles Babbage. So this is one of the first computers. And as you can see, this is a very large thing. Like it is, in general, the starting computers were of size of a city block. Okay, so like you can think if this is so much big, how much thing it can do. So basically, these computers were able to perform only simple operations like storing data, addition, subtraction, and like these things you can do by simple calculator as well these days, which is of the size of your mobile phone. Okay. But slowly and slowly developed, and as you can see, in 1936 we got the first freely programmable computer where you can code a few things and then it can do some simple things on its own. Then in 1956 we got our first operating system, which was by IBM. Then in 1970 we got a robot. Many of you must be interested to know about robotics and all. And then in 1991 it was a big as you all have been using from quite some time, the birth of internet. And then now we have an age of artificial intelligence. Okay, so here also I have two pictures. Can you guess what is in the first picture? Anyone? I think it's a readily used thing. Google Maps. Yeah, so Google Maps is an excellent example of combined use of GPS, path planning, and data science these days. And yeah, someone wrote for the second picture also. So that was my next question. So as you can see, machines today can take many logical decisions and perform complex tasks and so much more. One thing which you note that slides back, I show a computer which was very large and did very minimal things. But here, these are like you can take them and carry them in your pockets, and these can do so many things. So one of the big things about electronics is that it is as good as it is. Oh, Hindi. It is as good as it is small. Okay. So this is one of the greatest wonders electronics have found so far. Okay. Next. So Okay, can you tell me some cool fancy names of whatever you have about some recent technologies? Maybe you were talking them with your batchmates or your seniors. Anything which has been developed recently? No new technology. Deep learning. Okay. Yeah. Quantum computing. Self-driving cars. By the way, I named the self-driving cars a few slides back in 2018. So you can't use it right now. I already told it. Qubit. Quantum computing. Okay. So, like some of you have named some things which we will be talking about in this session later. Okay. And please do follow if you want to learn about all this. Okay, a few slides back, I was talking about a smart speaker. So just as an example, we want to talk how a smart speaker works. So first of all, you say something to the speaker. And first of all, it has to remove some noise. So the first step is noise removal. Then it converts this signal to text. And this comes under the field of speech recognition. And we have some big fancy names in the third corner. You know, natural language processing, natural language generation. All this is very complex, right? You all must be wondering that how we all got this. And basically all these things are, am I audible? Okay. Yeah, all these things are a product of hundreds of years of hard work by many scientists and all. So, yeah, you can go on. So let's start fresh and think how all this started and how we all get through this. Okay.
So, hello everyone. So you just saw some advanced technologies. You saw Google Maps, you saw smart speakers, and even more, self-driving cars and everything. So you might be wondering, these are a lot of advanced technologies. What can we do? What can we as students do? So we can't like sense of the advanced technologies right away. So let's get into the basics of it. Let's get into the building. So a lot of things actually are not as complicated as you think. So you'll be doing things in this club that you might not have dreamed of. You might not have thought you'd be able to do in college. So let's get into the basics of electronics, which is what we do and what we can do in this club. So first thing I'd like you to understand is analog and digital. So do you know what analog and digital, the difference is, apart from what is written here? I'll be seeing the chat. So I'll say what it is. So defining analog is a difficult. Let's first into digital. As the name suggests, it works on digits. So it has 1 and 0. So, okay, I like some answers in the chat box, they're right. There is no 1.5 or 0.5 here. So it's only digits. 1.5 is not a digit. So here we can only have a 5-volt signal or a 0-volt signal. So there's no in between value. In comparison, we can see that analog signal can be any value in between. It can be 5, it can be 0, it can be negative 5, it can be 5, it can be root 2, or any value in between that range. So that is analog and digital in the context of signals. Not just in the context of signals, you can understand from daily life itself. Imagine a light bulb. So it can only be either on or off. There is no state that the light bulb is half on and half. That is a digital state. So clearly, can you give something with an analog state? Can you give something in that box? Okay, temperature of the surrounding. That's a very good example. So it's not a digital value. It can be any value. So I see a question. So that how will we keep up with the club if not from electrical department? This is not an electrical department club. Okay, everyone can keep up and we'll be teaching everything you need to. You'll see that in tomorrow's workshop. So analog and digital. Let's move on to the next topic. Just basic circuit components. So I'm pretty sure most of you have seen these things, at least pictures of them. Can you guess what they are? Okay, I'll slow down. Resistors, capacitors, and LED. That is correct. So the first one is resistor. Second one is a capacitor, and the last one are LEDs. So these are three basic circuit components. Are these the only three? Of course not. There are a lot of circuit components, more than listed in an introductory session, and you will be working with a lot of them in the upcoming days in the club. So you'll get enough introduction to them coming days slowly. I'll not dump all of them on you at once. So these are just some of them. So one important component that I'd like to introduce you to right now is the breadboard. Some of you might be familiar with it. Others, don't worry. I'll explain. So a breadboard is where you make circuits. It is on which you make circuits. You can see there is a circuit made on this breadboard. It is a board with a lot of holes. And how it works is that the holes are connected. Particular holes are connected. And I'll show you the next slide. You can see there are rows in the breadboard, many rows of holes. And all these, each row is connected, which means A, B, C, D, and E connected in each row. So if you want to connect two wires, so what you can do is you put one end of one wire in A slot, and the other wire you put in. So these two are connected, and now they are connected. So that is how the breadboard works. Each row is connected, and remember that the middle bar separates the rows. So the A, B, C, D, E is not connected to F, G, H, I, J. Connected. And then there is a long vertical row, which is connected all the way. That is from top to bottom. This is used for power connection. So this is used for power connection. Suppose you want to connect a battery, you can put a positive ended terminal here, the negative terminal here. And then any element that needs a battery can be taken from this end. So now you can go back to the breadboard and you can understand what is happening here. So a lot of points are connected. This resistor and this wire is actually tied together because they are in the same row. So one thing I'd advise you about breadboards while making circuits, you can see that this is a very neatly made circuit. The wires are exactly the correct length they need to be. This is actually very good practice. If you use longer wires and if you use a messy circuit, it can be very difficult to understand what is going on. So dangling wires is not good. So try to wire your circuits like this very precisely. Okay, so that's about breadboard. Now what after breadboard? What after breadboard? So as I said, this is used for designing circuits, right? So once the circuit is designed and we have completed this and we are sure we've done it, so the next step is a printed circuit board. This is something you might have seen. Almost all chips come like this. There's a green board and there are a lot of components and lines on it. So do you know how this works? Does anyone know how this works? Lines are like wires. That's a good concept. Magic. In a way, this is when we're looking without the basics, without the knowledge of the basic, this is magic. It's copper plates inside the frame base. Okay, so there is a lot of ways this can work. So one way is using graphene wires, another is using conducting and insulating material. So basically, when a circuit is final, you can print them onto the circuit. So why is this helpful? This is helpful because it makes the circuit very much compact and precise. You don't have to worry about two wires accidentally touching each other. And we can see that a lot of space is utilized as well. So this is used when we're finally manufacturing the design, when it's final. So that is PCBs. Now we go on to the next step of electronics, which is sensors. You all know what a sensor is, right? A sensor, as the name suggests, senses something. It detects events or changes in its environment. And this is a bit of a technical jargon. There is active and passive. So an active sensor measures something by the reflection of something. Okay, the little boxes are ICs, yes. So the active sensors are measuring things using a reflection. So the sensor sends out a signal or wave and then waits for the reflection. And then using the reflection, it makes a measurement. While passive sensors do not need this. So I'll explain with an example. You've all probably heard of sonar. You've studied in your previous classes. It is used to, what is sonar used for? You probably know, but just checking. What is sonar used for? S-O-N-A-R, sonar, depth of sea. Yeah. So how it works is it sends a wave to the bottom of the ocean and it hits the bottom and it comes back. So without sending this original wave, there is no way that it can measure. So that is an active sensor. Meanwhile, passive sensor does not need to do this. It does not need to send out a signal to get a result. So can you give an example for a passive signal sensor, or can you give a measurement that can be taken without a wave being sent out. Measuring tape, TV antenna, right? Yep. These are correct. Another example is the one you used earlier, which is a temperature thermometer. Not a thermometer, the temperature sensor. All of these do not have to send out a signal to first measure. So these are passive sensors. So now let's see the examples of some sensors. Obviously, these are not all the sensors there are. These are just some examples. So here is one. This is an infrared sensor. So can you give some applications where this is used? Can you think of some? An infrared sensor is used. Remotes, automatic doors, TV remote, all of these are correct. So actually what is inside the remote and the automatic sensor? Sniperscopes. Good thinking, I guess. So TV, yeah. So that is an infrared sensor. And next we have a temperature sensor. So there's no question where it is. It's used wherever temperature has to be measured, like thermostat. Yeah, that's a good answer. And electric kettle, that is also correct. When the electric kettle is smart enough to sense the temperature, that is. And on third, we have the touch sensor, which senses touch. Can you think of something? Think of an application where touch sensor is used. Fingerprint sensor, phone, smart appliances. There's one question there. Do we learn to make these modules? Or are the modules ready? So you could actually make these modules, but you don't have to, because these are like reinventing the wheel. You don't want to reinvent the wheel. These are very basic. So you would use them directly. Okay, so you have given a lot of examples for touch sensor also. Now let's move on to the next few sensors, which are slightly more advanced. There is a humidity sensor. Like this more advanced circuitry inside them. So it is used wherever we need to measure the heat. So, and that's that. And there is a light dependent resistor. Is this a sensor? It is a sensor, but it's also a resistor. It's a component that acts as a sensor. And finally, we have an inertial measurement unit. This is a very interesting. Do you know what IMU is? Inertial measurement unit is? Anyone? No. So this is not actually one sensor. This is a unit. It has sensors inside it. So what it does is it measures inertial quantities, like acceleration, things like that. So accelerometer is inside in IMU. There is an accelerometer inside IMU. There is a gyroscope. So this is a complete package for motion, kind of. So wherever motion is required, you use an IMU, and it detects all those things, like everything that's related to like the position and velocity of it. And it's not a single sensor. It is a unit. So why I'm showing you this is an advanced tool. The previous slide, we saw very big sensors that measured one quantity precisely. So now we are combining a lot of sensors and then building modules. So that is the importance of an IMU. Now, before we move on to the next topic, I'll just introduce you to the systems if you don't know already. Most of you might already know. A number system, there are basically four widely used numbers. So one of them you already know, you all know, is decimal system, which is base 10. That's the normal numbers we use. And the other three are binary, octal, and hexadecimal. How this works is in the decimal system, there's a number 321. That is 3 into 100 plus 2 into 10 plus 1 into 1. And these 100, 10, 1 are powers of 100. So in the same way, the other number system works with powers of other numbers. So a number in binary would be, suppose a number in binary, then be powers of multiplied with the powers of 2. So if there are three digits, there'll be 8, 4, and 2. Okay, wait, I'll explain it. So in a binary number, where we have powers of 10 in a decimal number, like 100, 10, 1, there'll be powers of 2, like 8, 4, 2, 1, simply it goes like that. And same for octal and hexadecimal, there'll be powers of 8 and 16. So this part might be a little confusing to those who don't know yet. So I'll just give a simple exercise. To get it used, get you used to it. Okay, I'll put a number in the chat. Okay, it will be in binary. Can you convert it to decimal numbers? I'll put a number can you convert this number to binary? I'm doing this because this is not a subject we can verbally describe completely. Convert this to decimal number. 58. The correct answer is 79. So how we got that? This is for the people who don't know how this. So how we got 79 is that look at the number is 00 and 4 ones. So each one is a multiple of 2. So the first digit is 1 into 64. The next is 0 into 32. Next is 0 into 16. Next is 1 into 8. 1 into 4, 1 into 2, and 1 into 1. So that's a total of 64 plus 8 plus 4 plus 2 plus 1. And that totals up to 79. So that is how it works. Similarly, we can convert to other systems also. You can practice that. It's not necessary right now. So I'll be moving on to the next topic. You can practice it on your own, and you can also read up on this if you are interested. So after number systems, I want to integrated circuits, which is the next step.
Yeah, so now let's talk about IC. So you might already know that IC actually stands for integrated circuit. So anybody guess what IC is? Like, where do you find it? Some of the devices where you can actually find an IC. You can write your... Yeah, everywhere. Can you be a little more specific? Mobile phones, CPU, right? Yeah, so yeah, you're right. So IC is actually a device that is made of fabricated resistors, capacitors, transistors, and all the elements you actually just learned about. So in simple words, you can actually think of it as a black box that takes input from a set of pins, and then it gives an output that is test on the some other pins. So like you all just mentioned in the chat box, that computers, mobile phones, and all the kinds of digital home appliances, they're made of these ICs. So we'll be learning about some of the important ICs that we actually use in the club. And you might actually, they're kind of used in many of the devices, and you can also actually use it to create your own projects as well. So one of them is actually the 555 timer. It is an IC that is used to synchronize the events, like the name timer suggests. So what it does is that it can generate clock pulses of a given time period. And it has three modes, that is A-stable, mono-stable, and stable. And each mode actually represents a different type of circuit that has a particular output. So we're not going into the modes in depth right now. I'm just telling you what the modes are, because that would consume a lot of time. So after this session, you can probably Google yourself and then approach one of us, tell us that what using what mode, what kind of project you can create. So once you have generated the pulses, the next IC that we is a 4029 counter. So what a counter does is that it counts the number of pulses that have been generated by the clock. Now, supposedly when you're counting, you actually require memory, right? So let's say in order to count 4, you need to know that you've already counted 3. So a counter can also be thought of like it is used as a memory element that remembers its previous state. So like you can see in this this diagram, it has 4 binary outputs. So once you use a counter, you actually get a 4-digit binary output. The next IC that we'll be learning about is the 7447 segment decoder. So now supposing if you want to display the number in the counter output on a display, so you'll have to decode the bits and then match them to the pins. Now in this case, this is a 7 segment decoder. So you'll actually be using 7 pins. So you're matching the output of the counter to 7 pins. So that is what a 7 segment decoder does. And and this is the 7-segment display. So what it does is that it receives the input from the decoder, and the corresponding to that input, some of the LEDs would actually light up. So you can see in the image, there are 7 LEDs. So when some of these light up, you can actually see that a number would be displayed over here. And that would obviously be like a single digit decimal number from 0 to 9. Yeah, next is microcontrollers. So microcontrollers are microcontroller is a sort of an embedded chip that can execute programs and control gadgets. So like it is given over, like a microcontroller is basically made up of these elements that are mentioned in this image, that is the microprocessor, the memory, and the input and the output peripherals. So can you name certain like applications where a microcontroller would be found? Like you can actually think of like what kind of devices do you actually use in your day-to-day lives that that require input output peripheral? Yeah, phone. Okay, anything else? Yeah, printer. Printer is an example. Yeah, so like devices like mouse, drones, and calculators, and keyboard that actually use these microcontrollers. So it's pretty much found everywhere in all of the devices that you would use in your day-to-day lives.
Okay, guys, can you tell what is this photo in front of you? Any one of you can guess? Yes, very high, another chip, Arduino, right? Okay, by the way, this is one of the most popular things which we use in our club. And one of you, yeah, two, three of you guessed right. So it is an Arduino Uno board. So this is a small board. Next, please, for help. Yeah, this is the Arduino Uno board. Arduino is an open source hardware and software which is used to make single board microcontrollers and microcontroller kits for building digital devices. So basically, you can see it is a hardware part. It looks like a motherboard. Okay, I'm not focusing on the chats right now. Okay, so as you can see, a few slides back, we introduced you to the digital and analog things. So you see on the right side, we have 14 digital pins, and on the left side, we have 6 analog pins. And on the left side on top, we have some pins as well. So GPIO here, as you see on that as well, GPIO stands for general purpose input output pins. And you can use these pins as input or output. You can configure them accordingly in your project, and basically this acts as a joiner in your circuit. And this is a simple device, but you can make many complex digital devices using this. So, and you can also make very cool projects at your home, because this is not a very costly component. Also, as this is a very important thing, and as I said, this is one of the most popular things in our club. So we will be having a workshop tomorrow on how to work with Arduinos, and you can learn and have some hands-on exercise. And I think you guys must be interested in programming a lot right now. So you can also learn how to code in C on Arduino. Okay, so please join the workshop tomorrow for any of you who are interested. Okay.
So now that that's over, we can get into the domains of Electronics Club. Before I go there, let me ask you a simple question. The last few slides, was that quite intimidating? Like, did you feel that it's just too advanced? One person has said yes, some are saying no. So one advice I'd give you, like, when you don't know a subject, right, so it seems very complicated. Seems very advanced. Everything about it seems very advanced. So once you get the initial habit, it seems very easy. Remember in your 10th standard, you studied mathematics. You saw the series operator d by dx and doing very weird things, right? So the whole area of differentiation felt very complicated. But once you learned a few rules of differentiation, you could differentiate any function, right? So that's the same here. So once you know small details, that's a very, very first initial steps, it's very easy to go forward. And it's you don't know, you do not realize how easy it is to actually make very cool gadgets. So with that out of the way, let's now get into domains. I said this now because you might, after seeing the domain, think, is this actually possible for a college student like us? Can we actually work on this? The answer is yes, we can actually work on this. The answer is this is not that common. This is things we all can do. So what are the domains? Domains we'll be working on. So first we have embedded systems. Does anyone know what an embedded system is apart from what is written here? Can you give examples for embedded systems? An embedded system, just what the name suggests, it's a system that is embedded, that is placed on the system. So we have a lot of day-to-day objects, right? Right now you'll be watching this on a laptop, but it will be placed on a tabletop. And it have other things also on your desk right now. All of these are inanimate objects. And what embedded system focus on is actually giving computing power to day-to-day objects. So look at all these. So one guy, I don't know if it's a boy or girl. One person said earlier back about digital watches. So later on, we had analog watches. We had watches with needles, which we had to read to get the time. Now we have digital watches that show us the exact time. It is an embedded system. That is a computing system embedded onto the watch. Similarly, we have seen washing machines with digital displays and switches. And also another example is music display on your car, in your cars. So all of these are systems. Computing systems which are placed in other mechanical systems. So why is this interesting? It's interesting because we can give a lot of interesting functionality to today objects that we might not interpret as great, as smart. So suppose imagine a pencil. Right now a pencil is very dull object, just something you use for writing. But how can you turn it into a smart pencil? Can you give an embedded system onto it and turn it into a smart pencil? That's the area of embedded systems which we will be working on. Another area, and which is actually like a second step, is Internet of Things. So this is like a buzzword, so you might have probably heard of it. Have you heard of Internet of Things? Yeah. So does anyone know what Internet of Things is? No. Okay, so some people don't know, some people know. What is Internet of Things? So you know what Internet is, right? Internet is a connected network of computers. So the question is, why stop at computers? Why, if we have systems, if we have devices that have computing power, why can't we form a network of them? So that is the concept behind Internet of Things. So in this picture, you can see there is a grinder, a stove here, there's a lights, and all is connected to phone and they're interconnected also. So that is an Internet of Things. So I'll give an example how this can be used. Suppose you have a smart TV in your house, and suppose you have a lighting system also. Suppose you have a fitness tracker, which is also, all of these have embedded systems on. So in a, without an Internet of Things, all of these operate independently, right? And what can happen if there is a connection between them? So suppose the time is like AM and you're actually asleep, but you forgot to turn off the TV. And always after a long time of inactivity, they turn off by themselves, right? So in an Internet of Things scenario, when the TV is turning off, you can actually send a signal to lights telling that the user is probably asleep now. You can now dim the lights. The lights can send a signal to a fitness tracker saying the user is probably asleep now. You can start sleep tracking. So all of these things, these things are complete because there is intercommunication between all of the different devices in your house. So that is the area of Internet of Things, how we can profit from connectivity. This is actually, this could be as revolutionary as internet was to computers. So that's the next area of research. And next we go on to a weird name for you. Most, this is like not like the common names we saw in the last two slides. It's field programmable gate array, FPGA in short. So this is pretty complicated. A few slides back you saw ICs, right? So there was a specific IC for a function. You saw the timer, which was a timer. Use counter IC, which did counting or keeping memory. So these ICs were very specific functions. So what the problem here is that if you need an IC with a specific functionality, you can't do anything if the company is not making it. So that problem is addressed by FPGAs. So as I suggest, this is the important part here, programmable. So what happens is it's like an IC, but you can actually determine the functionality. You can determine how it works. You can write code which is written in specialized language, not like a common language or something. Specialized languages for FPGAs called hardware description languages, HDL. And we write codes in HDL. The examples are very low. And once we write that code, we can make this IC do what we want. So now it provides a lot of power onto us. We are not any longer at the mercy of companies. So it's only limited by our imagination and our technical ability. that provides a lot of power. This opens up a large area which is previously inaccessible. Now, the next item is signal processing. So what is signal processing? So you can see a definition here, says analyzing, modifying, synthesizing signals and all. I'll just give you an example. Have you heard of noise cancelling headphones? Yeah, so does anyone know how noise cancelling headphones work? How noise is cancelled? How is cancelled in a noise cancelling headphones? People are saying no. Ashutosh said they make anti-noise. Listening to. Okay, a lot of people are saying it's an anti-bit. What this means is the headphones, they have microphone to the outside, which records the noise level, which records the noise from the outside. And then it makes an opposite wave that destructively interferes. You've probably studied interference in class 12. Look at the third wave here. So you can see there's a blue wave and there's a pink, which is like exact opposite of it. So this will destructively interfere. So, and it will cancel out the noise. This is what I mean here. It analyzes a noise signal and it synthesizes an opposite signal to make it work. So a very simple concept like this can give a lot, an interesting and a very fascinating result. That is the noise being canceled out. Only your music is hearing, only your music reaching your ears. So that area is part of signal processing. There are a lot of other applications also, and that is the area called signal processing, where we process signals literally. And then we have the buzzword machine learning and artificial intelligence. I do not have to ask whether you have heard this or not. You probably heard this. If you don't, if you haven't heard this yet, you probably live in a cave. That's the situation of today. So it's literally everywhere. What is learning? Machine learning. Can anyone answer what is machine learning? No one's answering probably because it's a long answer. Okay, heuristics for machine system. Okay, just another question. What is the difference between a machine learning algorithm and a normal algorithm? Okay, so in a normal algorithm, we decide how it goes, right? A machine learning algorithm, the machine can actually see whether it's going in the right direction or the wrong direction and then accordingly. So that is a machine learning and artificial intelligence. I'm not giving a lot of intro on this, you already know. And when machine learning improves a lot, we get AI, artificial intelligence. Then the last one, that's computer vision. This is not the last one. This is the last one in the slide. There are a lot more areas also. So what is computer vision? Computer vision is processing visual input. So imagine self-driving cars actually have to process the road ahead of them. And they're doing this using computer vision. So that is another area of research and interest. There's a lot of applications here, like self-driving cars and many more. And we can also process live feed and also static files also, and object detection, a lot of applications like that. So these are just some of the domains of electronics lab working and some of the domains of electronics as a whole. Now let's just see a video of the past projects we have done in these fields.
Okay, guys, first of all, how was the video? Whatever you feel. Okay, nice, cool, nice. Okay. Okay, so thing to notice is that here we create actual things. It's not only that we are sitting on a laptop and writing something and then posting it, etc., etc. We create real things. We do hardware stuff. So as you know, last year there was a major COVID strike. And we were forced to stay at our homes. Next slide, please. Yeah. So due to this transition to an online semester, we did pose a lot of problems. But yeah, like we are some enthusiastic people who want and need to create things. So like we accepted this challenge. And in the summer of 2021, we had some online projects as well. So I will tell you about that separately. Okay, so first of all, do you remember this Arduino which we were talking about a few moments back? So as I said, you can create many projects using this Arduino board, and one of them is Rustduino, which we did this summer. So the standard library for working on Arduino is made in C programming language, but the project was to make it in a Rust programming language. You might be hearing this name first time. So we made a library for this Arduino, and you can see in this video, this is one of the basic tasks which an Arduino can perform. It is a blinking of an LED. You can see how this LED is. Okay, what's Arduino? As I said, everything is continuous in this PPT. First you learned about digital and analog circuits, then Arduino. And then this is a project which was done using an Arduino. So it was told a few slides back, as I said. Okay.
Yeah. We just like talked about smart speakers and speech recognition in the beginning of the PPT, right? So this is like one of those interesting applications that we actually got to implement in the summers. In this project, we got to implement an approach that is quite similar to speech recognition. So we created computational algorithms that can actually convert music signals into a musical notation, which is piano roll in this case, like you can see in the image. And for this, we use some deep neural networks, the recurrent neural networks, and the convolutional neural networks. Yeah, then 3D pose swapping. So in this project, we actually worked on reposing the human pose into any desired pose. So as you can see in this picture, there is an input image and then there is a desired pose. So the input image gets converted into the desired pose, which can be seen in the output image. And it all happened after passing the input through a deep learning model, which we created from scratch. I hope you all find that really cool, right? And it finds application in filmmaking and animation and areas like that. Yeah. Next is the crypto FPGA. So we just talked about field programmable gate arrays. So again, so we implemented the DES algorithm with the help of Verilog. So Verilog, like we just told you, is an HDL, that is a hardware description language. And DES algorithm is something that we actually learned about. It stands for data encryption standard, and it can actually convert any input in plain text to an encrypted message, like you can see in the image right over here. So using FPGAs, we were able to increase the efficiency of the algorithm. So we, the members of Electronic, participate in a lot of competitions as well. So some of the competitions that we participated in are given over here. Like in 2020, we participated in International Signal Processing Cup and we stood sixth. And in the last edition of the Inter-IIT Tech Meet, that is the 9th edition, we bagged 2 gold medals in Drishti's Tech Meet Innovation for Rural Entrepreneurs and Bosch's Traffic Sign Recognition. And in the Inter-IIT Tech Meet that was held before for this one, we got 1 gold and 2 silver medals. The upcoming events, what do we plan for you guys? So of course, like we have a plan a lot for you guys. First of all, we'll be having a workshop for you guys tomorrow, and we hope to see a lot of you all tomorrow. So we've also planned projects where you can actually get to implement whatever you learned today. And then we'll be having a winter camp where we're diving deep into the domains that we covered briefly today. and this will be followed by technique, where you'll actually get to work upon a specific problem statement, followed by some exciting summer projects that actually take up in the upcoming summers. And you can actually connect with us on social media handle. Yeah, stay updated. If you have any queries, you can actually post it in the chat and we'll try to take them up in soon.
If you can raise your hands, try to use the voice function. You can raise your hands, you can also, if you want to speak up.
Yeah. So Sahil, maybe you can unmute yourself and ask.
Yeah, so I want to ask, like, would you get a chance to make projects at home, or you will only demonstrate through experiment?
Okay, so during the presentation, we have shown you many projects specifically also. Did you saw them?
Yeah.
Yeah, so they all were done. Yes, who are the secretary right now at home only. So don't worry about that. We have already done that. Okay.
Yeah, like and if you want to like work on a specific project, then you can contact any of the secretaries and we can guide you and help you with the project.
Okay. And will you share the slides?
Yeah, slides will be shared after the session.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
So I wanted to ask you with the timing for tomorrow's session. Because we have a test also, quiz.
Like, what is the timing of the quiz?
Quiz is 5:30.
5:30 to?
6.
Okay, we will try to organize it around this. Which is not disturbed.
Yeah. Like up until now, the timing 6 to 7, and if we get to know that if any event or any quiz is there during that slot, we will shift it. Okay.
Okay.
And check the Discord channel for the updates. Cool.
Thank you.
All right. What will we covering in tomorrow's workshop? Yeah, so there will be two sort of hands-on activity, one involving ICs and the other involving Arduino. The exact problem would be explained in the workshop, like during the first briefing.
The workshop is you get a problem statement and then you will solve it by the end of it. You make something by the end of it. Okay. Are there any questions in the chat?
If some of your questions remain unanswered, you can ask on Discord also, okay? You can ping us on the channel, Discord channel. We are always available there, okay?
One question, will we need anything for the workshop? You won't need anything for the workshop. Even the components you saw today, they can actually be very easily seated on software. There is a software called Tinkercad. Some of you might know already. So Arduino, even the Arduino functionality can be conveniently done on Tinkercad. There are other software also for simulating all these things. So you will not need anything for tomorrow's workshop. And even for the projects that we will be planning for you, because we will keep in mind that you are at home and we'll only plan things that you can do at home. You don't have to worry about that. There's a question, if I go to the robotics club, will it be complementary to each other? It's not exactly complementary. Be areas of overlap, but we focus on different things. Robotics club focus on the robotics aspect, while we are actually a broader division. Robotics can actually come as a subfield here because it is actually applications of electronics, it can go further, like broader, more broader, it can go more broader areas. So one question here, one person has an Arduino, doesn't know the basics. So can they contact? You can surely contact us. You can so attend tomorrow's workshop where you'll learn a lot about the Arduino. And for further information, you can contact us. We'll guide you to what a resource will show you what you can use. All this help will be provided, don't worry. Anyone wants to ask on voice, they can also raise their hands. It's no problem. Three people have already done it, so don't feel afraid to do so. So this is not just one doubt. It's a common thing that you might be thinking. You don't know many things. What should you do? So the truth is none of us, like most of us didn't know when we came here. And we are taking session for you today. So as I said before, it's not that hard to learn. And you're all IITians. You are fast learners. You will be easily able to learn. So don't worry about that. Most of it will be covered soon, like in workshops and events in winter camp, all of that. So we don't assume that you know a lot of things. That's our main point. We do not have any assumptions. We put in one of the first slides was prerequisites. We said there's no prerequisites. We do not assume that you know any of the things. We teach you everything from scratch. And if even that is being a problem for you, you can always approach us and we will provide additional help also.
Okay, do you have any other questions?
Just one about their whether they can use projects we do on our CVs. Depends on the size of the project. Doing a very serious project with us, you can surely use this on your CVs. That'll be great. Don't see it as for your CV. It's much more interesting. The doing it part. Don't see it as something to boast your CV. That's not how it is. Like, you will see it. When you start doing it, you will see that it's much more enjoyable.
Okay. Thank you, Hisham. I think that's it. We should end the session. Thank you, everyone, for joining us. We'll be sharing our presentation. And you can then check the contact links and follow us for further updates. We will be having our workshop tomorrow. Further details will be conveyed via Discord. So stay tuned. I hope you enjoyed our presentation. Okay, so let's ending.
Stay tuned.